Hi guys, my name is Sean. I'm a houseplant enthusiast from Jakarta, Indonesia. I'm here with Yudi at Bogor Botanic Gardens in a new Nepenthes enclosure, where actually they do have a few other carnivorous plants in this enclosure, but primarily it's a Nepenthes exhibition.
Yes.
Is this permanent?
Yes, this is permanent and for free.
All right, so for those of you, please do stop by if you're interested to learn. And can you tell us a bit about what you do?
Okay, I'm Yudhistira, and it's a great opportunity to welcoming you. I act here as the head of Department of Conservation, and I specialize in exotic plants, especially carnivorous plants. And I help the whole team in Kebun Raya Bogor to develop the whole greenhouse, as we can see here. And for this greenhouse, it's included when you go to Kebun Raya Bogor. And this greenhouse is closed for public at Mondays only for maintenance.
Yes, and so you're a carnivorous plant collector, and you're very passionate about it. You research and you study it.
Yes,
and
of course.
We're going to be sharing a lot of information in this episode about what they are. We're going to define it, maybe like go through a few of the morphology, like what are the pictures. And in the next episode, we're going to be looking at some of these Nepenthes that may be easier to care for than is attainable. And we're going to share some care tips for you guys. So two really cool episodes on the Nepenthes. Enjoy. What are carnivorous plants? Why they evolve the way they do?
Okay, so it's gonna be a long explanation, but I hope it can be fun. I'm gonna explain it in a fun way. So one thing, for especially for Nepenthes, right, they develop a carnivorous syndrome. And carnivorous syndrome itu we can explain as they attract insects, they also produce something sweet, some kind of nectar, so they attract the insects and they trap them and they digest them. So if other plants only catch the insect but they don't produce the enzyme for to digest the insect, they cannot be categorized as carnivorous plants. And the first thing that we should know why they develop a carnivorous syndrome, as we can see here, since we replicate their own natural habitat, usually they live in a poor nutrient soil, contrary to the other hobbies, since for airways they need a good soil, a fertile soil, but for carnivorous plants mostly they live in a poor nutrient soil. And as you can see, usually they live in the forest. And maybe some of you gonna be ask some question like, there is a lot of leaf litters, right, in the forest. So it must be a lot of nitrogen for Nepenthes. But one thing we should know, usually they live in a tropical rainforest and it's very humid. So they compete with fungus, with leaf litters like this. There is a lot of fungus, right? As you can see in here, there is a fungus that eats the leaf litters, and the fungus already consume the nitrogen or the nutrients. I see. And with the high frequency of rains, the rains gonna wash away all of the nitrogen nutrients. And one interesting thing is their predecessor or their ancestors. A lot of scientists conclude that their digestive enzyme is mostly to consume chitin.
Chitin
is the components, especially in the outer carapace or exoskeleton of insects, the hard shell. Like beetle, right? When you press the beetle, it's very hard. And as we can see, the scientists said fungi is also consist from chitin. So in the beginning, when they don't develop this trap, they use the chitin or the proto-digestive enzyme to compete with the fungi. And through the time, some idea pop up in their mind. And they think that if we can consume fungi, why don't we use the anti-chitin enzyme to consume the insect? So we don't have to compete with fungi anymore, and we just get the nutrients from the insects. And that's why they evolve slowly. And one interesting thing is their predecessor is considered to be from South Africa, named Tripiophyllum. It's the only sole species in the world. And we can say that it is the predecessor or the proto-carnivorous plants since they have the same morphology as Nepenthes. Hmm. As you can see, mostly in aroids, especially Philodendron, they are hemiepiphyte.
Okay.
They grow up, they are climbing the trees, and they put out aerial roots. But for Nepenthes, they also climbs, yeah. But they don't put out aerial roots. Yeah. So they are categorized as liana. Liana plants, as you can see in here, they are grow up and they climb the surrounding vegetation using these tendrils.
Oh, they actually catch it with this?
Yeah, they actually gonna swirl around this stem to make them easier to climb.
Yeah.
And as you can see in here,
they
can sense that there is some branch or some stem that they can swirl.
So this is all true for all Nepenthes?
Yeah.
Alright. Uh-uh. Quick question. The ancestor you were talking about from South Africa, is that the main ancestor for all carnivorous plants, including the Americans?
Oh, no. Different. Only for Nepenthes.
For South African Nepenthes, are there many species there now?
They are still, and it's very hard to conserve.
Okay.
As long as I know, there is only 3 botanical garden who did the conservation for Tripiophyllum.
Okay, but they're the ancestors and somehow they evolved and then now they're largely a huge diversity here in Southeast Asia and primarily in Indonesia. Can I say that it's where it's most diverse or?
Indonesia, we can say as the number one diversity for Nepenthes since we hold around 65-70% of the total Nepenthes population in the world.
That's amazing.
Okay, then after we know how they evolve, as we can see before that mostly they grow in tropical rainforest in between many leaf litters, we can see two more unusual habitat like this. This one is a mountain habitat or cliff. Usually they grow instead of leaf litters, they grow between the crevices.
Is this higher elevation or not?
Yeah, usually the one who lives in the cliff like this is intermediate to highland. Some Nepenthes that lives in the cliff like this prefer different requirement. As you can see, usually in the tropical rainforest, they live in the swamp, a swampy area with a lot of litter and a lot of tannin.
Yeah.
So it can be considered as lethal for normal plants. Yeah. And for these cliff dwellers, usually they prefer more porous. They don't like to be getting their roots saturated with water.
Yeah.
And some scientists also said that they prefer more natural media. They don't like very acidic media.
Okay, makes sense. For swampy areas, you tend to get more acidity, right? Now, a really question to follow up on our story. So the early Nepenthes does not put out pictures like this. It took them, what, millions of years? Or how many years do you know roughly in the history?
I think it's million of years since the Tripiophyllum, their ancestors, the carnivorous part is only the leaves.
Yeah.
They are not developing the pitchers, but they only developing this tendril as liana to swirl against the vegetation.
Yeah. So they got better and better over the years.
Yeah.
Depending on their environment as they spread out.
Yeah. And as a proof, as we can see like this picture, usually they develop a bright coloration like this.
Yeah.
And if we are a fly, we can consider this coloration as a rotten meat.
Oh, that's what it's for. Okay.
And one of the scientific proof is when the scientist using UV light, like the insects, right? They are using different vision like us. It's very bright for them.
Okay.
Yeah, so they're gonna be attracted because of the nectar glands and because of the coloration.
I see, but they also, the nectar is probably produce smell or something.
Yeah, smell. Usually we can spot the nectar glands in the bottom of the pitchers like this, as we can see.
Yeah.
This black or brown spot is the nectar glands.
Yeah.
And we can see some in the leaves like this.
Ah, interesting. Hmm. So that's what attracts them.
Yeah.
To come.
Uh-uh.
So my gosh, so they are actually, I mean, this looks like a normal plant that we know. So over time, their carnivorous behavior started in the leaves. They started over time figuring out to get better and better at digesting animals. So they actually do have an enzyme that's unique to its own genus.
And one interesting thing is it's like our digestive tract. Mm-hmm. When something is not inside, it's considered natural. But suddenly when there is insect, but in cultivation sometimes rat also can be trapped or mouse.
Yeah.
Somehow the enzyme gonna be reduced to acidic.
If it's inside the pitcher.
Yeah.
Okay, with the animal in it or without?
With the animals.
Without the animal, yeah. It's still kind of neutral.
Sometimes mouse accidentally trapped and it's totally digested around 3 weeks.
Oh my god.
Only bones and hair. Yeah, maybe this is not recommended, but since this one is for education.
Yeah. Don't try this at home. Yeah. So this is not acidic.
Yeah.
At all.
And it's not dangerous for us.
Yeah. Interesting. And we're going to talk in the next episode that maybe some of these enzymes are also important for them. They do need it to have their pictures wet. Right?
Yeah.
We'll discuss that
course.
In the next episode. really quickly, so they all have different shapes and forms. Some of them have like large leaves with little
elongate pitchers or tubby and squat pitchers.
Okay, so this is all in evolution to their natural habitat.
Yeah.
How is this?
Like this one. This one gonna be very big, like this, and they need it to enter between the cliff.
Yeah.
As you see, like there is a lot of risk in the cliff, like avalanche or else or heavy rain. So the big pitcher can be used as an anchor.
Yeah, and all of these, like every single design here, they serve a purpose, correct?
Of course.
Other than the color, you mentioned the color.
So we can start from the lid.
Yeah, the lid here.
This lid, usually there is no new pitcher, but when they are still developing, it holds the moisture, so the digestive enzyme is not evaporating outside.
Okay.
But when they go outside, this lid usually preserve as a nectar glands too. As we can see, sometimes in the heat of the sun, we can touch this lid and you can lick it. And the taste is usually sweet.
Okay, he just put that in his mouth, by the way. But don't try that at home. Maybe it is. It's safe, right?
Yeah, it's
so
safe.
So it can actually taste sweet when you the nectar over here.
So when the pitcher fully open, and this peristome is usually consists of waxy coating. So it's very slippery for insect. As we can see, my fingers is slipping in the peristome. And this part of pitchers is also waxy coat.
Okay.
So insects usually slip into here and fall into the trap.
I see. My gosh. So again, all of these features are evolution, and I don't know if my audience is know what evolution is or familiar with it, but it is something that it takes time for them to get better and better through natural selection.
Yeah.
So the ones with these desired traits are the ones that survive in the wild to pass on their genes. To the next. That's fascinating. Like carnivorous plants are the total perfect examples of evolution, or proof of evolution. Sorry to interrupt. And
when plant raids against the insect. And there is another two interesting thing. Usually the pitcher consists of two parts. The upper part is the waxy coating to make the insects fall. And usually the you can see the waste, right? In this. This is the digestive area.
Okay.
So it don't contain the waxy coating.
Yeah.
And you can see this some kind of wing, right?
Yeah, what else?
This serves as a ladder for ground insects.
That's funny.
Yeah.
That is
so
hilarious.
When it's in the ground, insects can climb into this very easily, right? Because it's not waxy, and they're gonna collect the nectar around the peristome, around here, and they're gonna fall.
It's like stairways to heaven. Is it a song?
Or even highway to hell. And the most interesting thing, they know, they have two kinds of pitcher, the lower pitcher and the upper. Maybe we can see the upper pitcher after this. And for upper pitchers, since they gonna be climb very tall, they lose the wings.
They don't need
because
it.
They know they gonna catch the flying insects.
They're smart. I mean, each of these features it takes energy
they
to
know.
Use, so they have to be efficient about what they
put. Yeah. As this picture, the Krangas habitat or heat forest habitat. In Krangas or heat forest habitat, as we can see, the top surface is usually consists of silica sand, and there is also a small organic matter like leaf litter on else. So they can be considered nutrient poor.
Yes.
And as we can see, this Nepenthes also played a very important role since they act as pioneer plants. Mm. And Krangas or heat forest act as the beginning of the tropical rainforest. You see, when it's not inhabitable by other plants, yeah, the pioneer plants gonna grow and lot of their leaf litter gonna accumulating and contributing to the accumulation of the organic matters. Yeah. And slowly but surely, the rainforest gonna grow from the Krangas. That's why we should conserve the Krangas or heat forest.
Interesting. So then, what happened to them after the forest establishes? These usually they spread out further, or they die out, or what? Or they become part of the forest?
As we can see in Indonesia, usually there are only 4 to 5 kind of Nepenthes.
Okay.
And 4 or 5 of them usually also exist in the tropical rainforest. Okay. So we can assume by science that they still grow in the forest.
Yeah. So they actually can take a bit more light than we think, because
yeah, Krangas is very hot,
yeah,
sunny.
Yeah. There's like no cover at the time, and it's usually caused by what, human activity or like sudden loss of habitat, basically.
Yeah. Of course, the first problem gonna be our environmental activity by human,
yeah,
and the second one is by nature, usually by fire.
Mm.
Because Krangas is very hot, right?
Okay, and another good thing about Nepenthes is they are the indicator of the healthy forest. Like as we can see in Java, there is only 3 kind of Nepenthes. Nepenthes spatulata, Var Adriani, and then Nepenthes gymnampora, and Nepenthes mirabilis. And usually for Nepenthes, as we can see, they are attracting ants. This is Nepenthes spatulata, but in Java, some people also say this one is Nepenthes adriani. Mm-hmm. They are synonym, since spatulata is vastly spread from Sumatra to Java. Okay. And usually in highland Nepenthes like this, they live in the mossy forest, and they can grow as epiphyte like orchid.
Okay.
And there is a misconception usually for hobbies or the newbies. They say that Nepenthes is orchid family, but they are not.
Yeah. And you said they are a sign of a healthy forest because? Mm-hmm.
Because the first thing is, as we can see, Java only has 3 compared to any other island. As we know, Java is full of development, human activity, yeah, and they cannot grow nicely compared to other island.
So let me summarize what you're saying. And based on this enclosure, you can see there are many tables. This is Sumatra. That's all like Sumatra. And then there's like the Kalimantan and Papua section. But in the Java, you only see a tiny amount of diversity of the Nepenthes. And this is due to the human activity in Java. Java is the most populous, what do you call it? Is it a continent or an island?
It's islands.
Island. Java is the most populous island in Indonesia that has been heavily contaminated by human behavior, and we've only managed to identify 3 Nepenthes from the entire Java island, which is blowing my mind. But we're seeing hundreds and hundreds of species in undisturbed forests in Sumatra and Kalimantan.
Nah, this is for nerd or geek plants like us. This one is Nepenthes bical carata. Like the name said, bical carata, double fang, like Dracula.
Oh yeah, I see that.
As we can see. And it also attracts a lot of ants.
Yeah.
These fangs also act as nectar glands. As we can see, the ants is collecting nectar from here.
Yeah.
And they can sleep when they visit the fang. Yeah.
That's funny. Someone should make a human game show of that. Where people try to hang on to like these fangs, the slippery fangs. Because I can see like the camera is gonna focus. I can see like they're just playing like this. Basically like a game, like to see who falls off first.
Mm-mm. And another interesting thing in the habitat, especially Borneo,
yeah,
they develop a symbiosis with a specific species of ants. I forgot the name of the ants,
yeah,
but as we can see, the tendril insertion in the bottom of the picture is very thick.
Okay.
See, it's slim and suddenly it's gonna get wider,
yeah,
from this thing. And the specific ants gonna make a hole in here to make a nest.
Oh, so live dangerously close to death.
Yeah, but they are not in predation system, but we can consider it symbiosis.
Okay.
The ants sometimes sleep and gonna be food, but the ants gonna take excessive food from the pitcher to prevent the decaying of the pitchers. Since if they eat so much, the pitchers gonna be wilt or decay.
Okay, so they kind of eat from each other in a way.
Yeah.
So how would you even call this symbiosis? Symbiosis.
The people, natural balance.
Yeah. Symbiosis is when people, when two plants and animals, they actually benefit from each other. But
yeah.
This is in a way, kind of a twisted,
scary,
a twisted, sick game. But the word that you were using is symbiosis. Is that the right word for carnivores? Is this actually symbiosis, or is this like something else?
Symbiosis, mutualism. Mutualism, symbiosis. And there is another interesting thing. This is Nepenthes hemsleyana, the close family of Nepenthes rafflesiana. And it also developed a symbiosis with a specific species of bats. Yeah.
Okay.
When the Nepenthes reach the mature stage, it produce an upper pitchers.
Yeah.
And the bats gonna sleep in the pitchers.
Oh my god. Okay.
Yeah.
We're gonna have to find photos of that. And why is that? Do you know? What is there a reason?
It's very unique since scientists also observe the bat. Like they put 5 Nepenthes, different Nepenthes, and they insert the bat, and the bat always use the hemsleyana by their sonar frequency. So I think they have a preference for the shape of the pitchers.
Yeah.
It's very comfy for them.
Yeah.
And another thing, this Nepenthes hemsleyana also got nutrients since the bat is also defecating, right?
Yeah, but they're not eating the bats, obviously.
Nope. Right? Uh-uh. Okay. It's like the pitchers is specifically developed for the bat's bedroom.
And you say the upper pitcher, not the lower probably.
Yeah, not the lower.
Low dwelling.
Only the upper.
And I think we I don't know if we mentioned earlier, but with a lot of these carnivorous plants, their lower pitchers and the upper pitchers are different, completely different purposes and morphology.
And this one is also interesting since, you know, there is a vegan trends right now, right?
Yeah.
For us. This is one of the a few Nepenthes that develops a vegan lifestyle.
Oh my god.
Named Nepenthes ampullaria.
Yeah.
As we can see, they live in a swamp or dense rainforest. They also exist in krangas or heat forest. Mm-hmm. And usually they put a lot of rosette.
Okay.
And as we can see, they are different since their lid is very wide open into the back.
Yeah.
So a lot of leaf litter or debris, they also called detritivore, they eat the leaf litters and digest it.
But they don't eat animals, or they do?
Usually they do, because the enzyme also digest the insects.
Yeah, yeah, so it's omnivorous. And ampullaris is a common, we're gonna see a lot probably in next episode.
Yeah.
It's a common and easy Nepenthes.
Hmm.
Are there different frogs? Because these are different from the ones that I see in shops and things like that.
For some, especially for hobbyists, enthusiasts, or scientists, this green form of ampullaria is considered the first of them all, the basic color.
Okay.
Their gene is very strong usually.
But we see other forms of ampullaria, and we call them ampullaris because the flowers, the DNA of the flowers.
The specific, there is a lot of ampullaria hybrids, but usually we can spot the difference in the lid.
Mm.
Pure species of ampullaria have the very lid, very thin lids like this, very
and
small.
And it says because they don't need to catch insects only.
Yeah.
Okay.
And they have a few nectar glands compared to other Nepenthes.
Okay.
They are slowly evolving into full vegan.
Okay, interesting.
The one of the most critically endangered Nepenthes in Indonesia or even in the world. Like as we can see, Nepenthes clipeata. Why it's endangered? Because of human activity, and they are endemic plants. They only live in Gunung Kelam or Mount Kelam in Kalimantan.
Hmm.
Kalimantan or Borneo's Indonesia's part.
Interesting. And the leaves have a peculiar shape.
Yeah.
And then the pitcher is under the leaves and they're smaller. Is that normal, or is this just a small plant?
That's why they are critically endangered, because they are highly soaked. High in demand for Nepenthes hobbyists. So it's threatened by the poaching and the high demand from across the country because of the unique shape of leaves and their rarity because they are endemic.
Yeah, and also they probably will be one of the mother, because people are hybridizing them left and right, so they may want to have this as a potential mother plant for something else.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, but quickly, we're going to talk about poaching and conservation without boring everyone to death. But they are heavily poached, correct?
Of course.
And they're heavily protected by the Indonesian government.
Of course.
Sometimes overly protected. We might not discuss in this episode. But they're nearly impossible to export. Is that correct?
Yeah.
You need CITES.
Because,
just like orchids,
of course.
To ship them out. So, yeah, number one, try not to poach or buy poached Nepenthes. And also, it's difficult to poach them these days, so don't even try.
Of course.
And yeah, and Indonesians, we're now coming into awareness, and we're trying to do our own conservation efforts, just like what Mr. Yudi did here at the Bogor Botanic Garden. All right, so is there anything you want to add to the topic?
Yeah, aligned with what Sean said. We as conservationists also happy because last time some poachers also try to poach the Klepiata and they are get catch by the local law enforcement.
Nice. What is the punishment? Is it imprisonment, fine?
Jail and fine.
Oh, this is serious business. Do you know how many years roughly? What is the
I don't know. Punishment? Since when I read the news, it's still in the process.
Okay. Interesting. Yeah, orchid species as well. There are a lot of poachers here. Please respect territories. If you must, you must go out for expeditions in Indonesia, welcome to our forest, welcome to look at it. But if you find something interesting, you have to describe it under our territory, under our laws. If you want to try to, I don't know, work with the local nursery, if you really want to get duplicates of it, and if you have managed to propagate it here locally, figure out a way to send it back to your company instead of sneaking it back in your luggage.
Yeah,
that is not
course.
The right way to do it these days. But the locals, I believe, like wherever region, like I don't know, this is a mountain, you said a specific region, it would really be beneficial if it was described
in the ecosystem.
There. Yeah, and then the local growers there get to grow it sustainably because this plant will do well when you try to multiply it in the same vicinity, the same region. Give it time, and then when it's become like something that is not endangered, that is probably when people are welcome to bring them home. That's
of course
correct, or am I being too idealistic?
I also agree because like Sean said, Klepiata is considered one of the most finicky Nepenthes. They need specific requirement that replicate Gunung Kelam habitat.
And I'm sure a lot of these Nepenthes, honestly, they're not the easiest plants to care for. They have specific elevation requirement, humidity, light. They can adapt over time, but this is not something you really want to chuck into your luggage and pray that it lives in your nursery bag where you are. So
now, before we already discuss about lower pitchers and their features, but as we can see here, this one is hybrid, a man-made hybrid, but we can take this as the example of upper pitchers.
Okay.
What make it a upper pitcher? There is a lot of categories. First, the tendril. As you can see, upper pitchers, the tendril is always curled like this, make a spiral.
Yes.
And the wings, like I already mentioned, is not exist.
Okay.
Because they specifically target flying insects.
Okay.
And usually the tendril also do the insertion from behind, not from the front like the lowers. And usually for upper pitchers, the pitcher is always smaller and not attractive. For species.
Interesting.
But for man-made hybrid, we can always mix the gene pool to make attractive pitchers, right?
But generally, when people are hybridizing, they're looking for interesting pitchers and also easy to care for plants.
Yeah,
correct.
Of
they
course.
They can adapt to different. Does this plant that we saw, does it have a lower pitcher so we can have an idea? Is this the lower pitcher?
We can trace the. Yeah. Lucky, we got the lower pitcher.
Oh, yeah. Oh, lucky.
This
day,
one is
guys.
The lower.
Yeah.
Maybe we can compare in the name of science.
Yeah. That's the upper. Yeah, so no stairways to heaven. And yeah, interesting. Slightly different. Yeah. And just so many people don't get confused, since we haven't discussed it, this is the leaf itself looks like this. And they put out these and the end of the leaves. And sometimes they're tendrils, sometimes they're pitchers. Is that correct?
Usually the tendril, if not getting enough humidity or likes, it's not making pitchers like this one.
Yeah. But you said earlier, sometimes they can lasso around and grab onto things.
Yeah.
Is that one of these functions as well?
Yes.
Okay, so the pitchers are actually part of the leaf.
Usually some people say that
picture is the modification of the leaves,
yeah.
But I personally have a personal hypothesis. To be more specific, pitchers is the modification of the stem or this midrib of leaves.
So it's not the leaf, but it's a modification of the...
But it's my personal hypothesis.
Okay.
Why? I have an argument since for hobbies,
yeah.
we also fertilize them, but fertilization is not recommended for newbies.
Yeah.
When I fertilize them with high P and K content, mm-hmm. and low nitrogen, the pitchers is very big.
Okay.
And the leaves is small. And what hobby is sick or Nepenthes enthusiast sick is the bigger pitcher ratio compared to leaves.
Yeah.
And I also notice when I give them high P and K and low nitrogen, the stem is also getting bigger.
Oh.
So we can assume P and K contribute to the stem.
Yeah.
And when the pitcher is getting bigger, aligned with the stem,
yeah.
we can conclude this one is also the modification of the stem.
Interesting, because leaves are generally fertilized by nitrogen, obviously. Mm. But is there any chlorophyll in the pitcher itself? Have anyone?
I have no idea. Maybe we should ask the more.
But it would be an interesting to know too. Like, if it's a chlorophyll, then maybe. Well, actually, that's not true. Stems have chlorophyll too. Maybe that is not the right question to ask. I take that back.
Or maybe I can give some explanation.
Yeah.
A lot of carnivorous scientists or researchers hypothesize that they sacrifice the photosynthesis aspect of the plants to make these pitchers. So pitchers is actually a big investment, a big burden, and very costly for plants by sacrificing some photosynthetic abilities.
Ah, I see.
And
so they don't photosynthesize these pitchers.
Maybe we can conclude like that, but we should maybe initiate more specific research. But one thing for sure, they also contribute to the hydration of the plants.
Okay.
Like when the roots is not getting enough water, they can also get fluid or water from the pitchers.
So they can the secondary storage.
Of course.
Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah, and maybe some people are a bit confused. Like, this is actually not the flower. This is the flower.
Ah.
It looks like this.
Okay. Another interesting thing, Nepenthes is dioecious plants.
Yeah.
It means like dragon fruit, salak gitu.
Yeah.
The male and female is separated, not in one plant.
Yeah.
And as we can see, it's lucky today we have male flowers, male plants.
How do you know it's a male?
Male flower for Nepenthes consists like these heat-seeking missiles.
Okay.
Like pointy with round tip.
Yeah.
For female flowers, it's more into oval, capsule like that, capsule shape.
I've heard about it, but I've never seen it in action. So yeah, I can see it's completely almost spherical here.
And another interesting thing, for male flowers, they smell like sperms or biclin or bleach.
Oh, sperm of like people and people.
Yeah.
Oh, I did not know that.
Our semen.
Should I try to smell this? Would it be disgusting?
Maybe we can. You can. Do you smell it?
Mm-hmm.
Like a bleach?
Maybe a bit.
It already not verifiable because it's 1 week, I think. Maybe in the first few days, the smell is very strong. Ah, and one thing you should know, especially for hobbyists like us, usually they are considered verifiable and emit a strong odor like that in the morning or in the late night.
Ah, I see. For pollination?
Because as we can see, their pollinator is not afternoon or days insects.
Yeah.
Usually they are attracting flies or moth.
Oh, okay, so that's our night time.
And another interesting thing, sometimes in the habitat they naturally hybridize with another species of Nepenthes, like this Rafflesiana.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes they hybridize with this Ampullaria, and the result is Nepenthes cross Hookeriana.
That one, the green one, right?
Yeah. Like this one, we can see both traits of the parents, right? The shape of Ampullaria, the fangs of the Rafflesiana, and there is a lot of variation. Like this one is also Nepenthes cross Hookeriana, but with red coloration.
So yeah, when you hybridizing, when you cross things, they can have different genetics varyingly.
Of course. And usually they are more vigor.
Okay. So we probably might discuss in next episode about care and recommendations, but hybrids are generally speaking more resilient and easier.
Of course, and recommended because it's also act of conservation, right? Since we don't disturb the pure species in the habitat.
So when you have a hybrid, it's basically grown in artificial.
Yeah, it's horticultural produce.
Okay.
Cool. It's not disturbing the environment, and while we speaking about environment, don't forget that Nepenthes also plays an important role for the ecosystem. Mm-hmm. They are predators, yes, true, correct. But sometimes they also provide home, the whole ecosystem for some creatures. Like as we can see, some species of jumping spiders lives in the pictures, and usually they hide until some insects come to visit the pictures and they catch the prey.
Oh, like they work together, and then the spider probably poops in the picture.
Yeah, most probably. And besides the spider, sometimes some swamp crabs or land crabs also lives and reproduce in the pictures. They mate, they put the eggs, and the larvae or nymph of the crabs also lives inside for protection.
Oh my god, so if we have a loss of habitat or loss of Nepenthes diversity, all these species are going to be in trouble.
Of course.
Interesting.
It's very interesting. And sometimes some insects or nematodes, some kind of worms, also can endure the digestive enzyme. Okay. So they are not digested, but they have the full metamorphological cycle in the pictures.
I don't know if I'm going to say this right, but I'm going to close it because I'm overwhelmed by what I'm learning today. But basically, there is a kind of truth between plant and animal world that is, the lines are very, very much blurred in this genus of Nepenthes and maybe other carnivorous plants, which we'll discuss in a future episode. But it's an unshakable bond. It's like they are mutually symbiosis, but it's also mutually, I don't want to say the word destructive, but there's an agreement that was also broken where normally an animal would eat a plant, but in this case, the plant would consume the animal. It is very, very fascinating. And it teaches us a lot about nature, about evolution, about resilience of life, and how nature gives and also nature takes at the same time. So there's a lot to learn and understand. I hope that you guys are interested to pick up some of these Nepenthes and try to grow them sustainably, of course, in your homes. And we'll discuss that in next week's episode. We're going to Mr. Yudi is going to introduce us to some care tips and also some species to start with or some hybrids to start with. And yeah, with that, I want to thank you for this episode. You've been such a wonderful host and guest. And I'll see you guys in the next one.
Bye-bye. Okay, bye-bye. Thank you.